Hi, I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to introduce the triangle spread rules, which are very important practical aids when doing trigonometric problems in the plane. So the situation is we have a triangle with its three spreads, S1, S2, and S3. And suppose that we know two of those spreads, say S1 and S2, and we want to determine the third spread, S3. How do we go about it? Well, I hope you know that the answer is contained in the triple spread formula. This is the relation between the three spreads of a triangle that replaces the sum of angles being pi in a classical trigonometric situation. So it's a formula involving the three spreads, which is quadratic in any one of the variables. So it's a quadratic equation that we need to solve. So the first step is to rewrite this so that the nature of the quadratic equation is more apparent. So here's an alternate, completely equivalent form to the triple spread formula, which has the S3 only in this spot right here. So it's an excellent exercise to unravel it and to get it from this formula to this expression here. S3 minus S1 plus S2 minus 2S1 S2 all squared equals 4 times S1 times S2 times 1 minus S1 times 1 minus S2. That's a very pleasant kind of expression that occurs quite a lot in rational trigonometry. This way, it's a quadratic equation in S3, and to solve it, you would take the square root of both sides. So you take the square root of this, and then the square root of this, this part would come over. So it would be S3 equals this quantity here, plus or minus the square root of the right-hand side. Now, geometrically, the two different solutions that you get correspond to two possible alternate configurations. So since the spread is only between two lines, say that spread there of S2 is the same as this spread between those two lines. Okay, that spread there is the same as that one there. And so there's really an alternate triangle, namely the one with sides like this, that have the same basic spreads S1 and S2 at the base. And so this spread up here would be the other solution to this quadratic equation. So in practice, what we want to know is which of the two solutions to this quadratic equation should we choose? So to answer this question, let's introduce a bit of new terminology. If we have two lines in the plane, it divides the plane into four different regions. Let's call any one of those regions a sector. So another way of describing a sector is in terms of a point and two rays emanating from that point. So let's call this ray going from A1 in the direction A2 and beyond the ray A1, A2 with an arrow above like that. And this here is the ray A1, A3. And two such rays also determine a sector, unambiguously now because of the directions of the rays. And we're going to introduce this terminology for that sector. So it's a double arrow kind of thing, A2, A1, A3. So from A2, A1, A3. So the middle point is the actual vertex of the sector. There's an arrow this way, an arrow this way. So this thing here represents the sector given by those three points. Now here are two important definitions concerning acuteness and obtuseness of sectors. We want to capture the idea that this is an acute sector right here, while this one here is an obtuse sector. But we don't want to talk in terms of angles. We would rather talk in terms of rational trigonometry concepts. So we say that the sector A2, A1, A3, using this notation, is acute precisely when this relation is satisfied. When the quadrants between A1, A2 plus the quadrants between A1 and A3 is bigger than or equal to the quadrants between A2 and A3. In other words, this quadrants plus this quadrants should be bigger than or equal to this quadrants here. In fact, this kind of relation goes actually back to Euclid, because Euclid realized that when we have equality here, that's the case of a right triangle. And that right triangle is halfway or balanced between the acute and the obtuse. And the difference between the acute and the obtuse is just which way the equality goes here. So similarly, on the other side, we say that the sector is obtuse when we have exactly the same equality, but with the equality here reversed. Now, the triple spread formula that we wrote down on the first slide had two solutions because it was a quadratic equation. And here are the two solutions written out explicitly. There's this quantity minus the square root of the right-hand side, and there's this quantity plus the square root of the right-hand side. And we're going to give these two expressions names. We're going to call this one the little solution, so RL, depends on S1 and S2. And this is the big one, RB, depending on S1 and S2. This one's little because we're subtracting this quantity, and this one's big because we're adding this quantity. And we're taking a square root here, so what, by definition, what's here is positive. So this number is definitely less than or equal to this number. All right, so in terms of that terminology, here are the two triangle spread rules. And they're concerned with a triangle like this, A1, A2, A3, with three spreads, S1, S2, and S3. And such a triangle determines three sectors, okay? Because we can talk about the rays emanating from one vertex to the other two vertices. So the sector at this point here will be the sector in the interior. And the sector here will be this interior sector, and the sector here will be this interior sector. Okay, so we're going to be talking about these three sectors now, and their spreads. All right, so the first triangle spread rule tells us that the third spread, in terms of the first and second spread, the third spread is the big solution of S1 and S2, precisely when S1 and S2 are acute, or they're acute sectors. Okay, if this sector is acute and this sector is acute, both of those, then the solution that we take is the big one. And if one of them is obtuse, then we take the little one. They both can't be obtuse because that's impossible. And the second triangle spread rule tells us that the S3 sector here will be obtuse precisely when two conditions. First of all, S1 and S2 are both acute. And secondly, the sum of S1 and S2 is less than or equal to 1. So the first is telling us which of the two solutions to the triple spread formula we should take. And the second triangle spread rule is telling us whether the S3 is going to be obtuse or acute. So let's do an example. Suppose that we have a situation sort of like this. Suppose that S1 happens to be 0.7 and S2 happens to be 0.6. Now in this case here, with this thing here, you can see that this is an acute sector, and this one is also an acute sector. So what does the triangle spread rule tell us? Well, there's a certain quadratic equation that's involved, and the first triangle spread rule tells us that since S1 and S2 are both acute in this situation, we should take the big solution to that quadratic equation. So when you plug these numbers into the quadratic equation, the big solution, the one with the plus sign, is 23 over 50 plus 3 over 25 times the square root of 14. And the second triangle spread rule is telling us whether S3 is obtuse or not. So what do we have to do? Well, we have to see, is S1 and S2 acute? Yes, they're both acute. Is the sum of the S's, S1 and S2, less than or equal to 1? Well, no, it's not, because 0.7 and 0.6 is 1.3. So this condition is not satisfied, and that means that S3 is not obtuse. It's acute instead. So that's telling us that this sector is actually an acute sector, and the spread is exactly this number. Now, you might be used to, in ordinary trigonometry, to writing out decimal expansions like this with approximations. I much prefer this. This is the actual accurate answer. This is only the initial part of a decimal approximation to it. Next time, we're going to see some more examples of how these triangle spread rules work in practice. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.